that I want to sort of relate to. This is what I showed you as well. So in principle, this is, oh God. Yeah, so this is the entire thingy, as I said, how can I trap a nanoparticle. And we said that all this whole setup has different functionalities, different components which have different functionalities, and just sort of analyzing those functionalities will essentially build up the course content. Okay, so the first thing that we thought was that when we had this laser, there is this lambda by 2 plate, but very critically, it actually passes through these different optical elements, which are dielectrics, and it reflects off these mirrors and all. And what is very important for these kind of experiments in optical trapping is the intensity has to be high, so that these mirrors have to be very highly reflective. And so that is essentially determined by these things known as, you know, the Fresnel relations. But more generally, these are determined by how electric fields sort of interact with a dielectric interface. So we have two different media of refractive index N1 and N2, and there's an interface, and there is an electric field, electric wave, a light wave, electromagnetic wave, that is, which comes and is incident, and then part of it gets reflected, part of it gets transmitted. And that sort of how that works is essentially given by the Fresnel relations. And you know, we derive those relations, we use the boundary conditions of the electric field. So before we enter into that, I will absolutely start from the very basics of our, you know, wave optics, as they say. And so what do you think? So let me write absolute basics of wave. So what do you think? Where do you know our study of waves, where does it commence from? What are the governing equations? The Maxwell equations, right? Can we just write those down? So Maxwell's equations are essentially the starting point of
Sir, yeah, one request from my side.
Yeah, please.
While presenting the screen, can you please switch off your video, because it takes more data.
Wait. Good. Let me do that. Okay. Yeah, completely.
Thank you.
Yeah, no issues. Acha, so as I was saying, so Maxwell's equations for a isotropic homogeneous medium. Can we write those down? This is the problem here. If we were doing a physical class, then I would have had you write down. But yahan pe. So what is the first one? Huh? Bolo koi boss, please. Del dot E. What is this known as? Kya? Are, why is that complete silence? Huh?
Divergence.
Yes, Gauss theorem. Gauss law. This one, what does this show?
No magnetic monopoles.
Nice. Then this one?
Faraday's law.
Equal to?
Del B del T minus.
Perfect. The last one is the most interesting one, right? Or not? Okay, well, all of them are very nice. But this one is... So, which one is Maxwell's real contribution? You guys think? addition of extra factor.
The Delhi delta term right now.
Yeah, absolutely.
So this is the displacement current, right? So this one we will actually deal with in detail. And this is essentially the effect of what? The displacement current is the effect of what? What? Why is the displacement current there? Why was it necessary? Huh? Arre boss, kya bolo? Ye sab to kiya tha. I'm sure you have done this thing, right?
Why was the displacement current?
Correct. Continuity equation comes from where? Which way? What is the problem? I mean, we'll do all this in detail, but I just want you guys to not sleep. I know it's a challenge in this kind of communication, but please. Yeah? So the continuity equation should say what? So if I take a del, if I don't have this term, or sorry, if I don't have this term, then what happens is what? If I just take a del, then the del dot j becomes zero. Right? So that means that the continuity equation is not satisfied. Right? So essentially we need a, so this is like the current density. J is the current density. And so that essentially means that the divergence or the rate of change of flow of charge is always zero, which is essentially not satisfying the continuity equation by any means, right? So in order to do that, Maxwell thought of this whole thing, and therefore you essentially came to the definition of D, which is nothing but this, right? So basically D is the effect of bound charges, right? So this is extremely critical, especially when we go down into an isotropic media. So typically when we look at isotropic media, D and E are in the same direction. There is not an issue. However, so basically this epsilon is the thing which sort of joins them, and P is of course the polarizability. Typically when epsilon is just a vector, I mean it's just a number, or it's a vector, or I mean it's just no it's I would say it's not a vector, of course it is essentially some kind of a it's like a 1D object, there's no problem. But when you actually go to an isotropic media, inhomogeneous anisotropic media, then what happens is that the properties in all directions are not the same. So what happens is epsilon no longer remains a single number, right? It becomes like a what?
Vector.
It becomes like a tensor. It has essentially three components, and it has x, y, z plus a lot of cross terms. At the moment that happens, D and E, they are not in the same direction, and then the whole story of course is different. Okay. However, the very crucial part is, so you know, displacement current is, I think, Maxwell's biggest contribution to this whole theory. But then, of course, we will, deal with displacement current and all probably at a later point of time. At this moment, we will just, again, get some basics through. So these are my Maxwell's equations. And of course, what is this most general solution? Is nothing but a plane wave, right? Where we write this as E is E0 sum E to the I kz minus omega t. So another convention that we follow is z is always the direction of propagation. Okay. This is a convention that we always follow in optics. K is of course the wave vector, and this is the most general solution of that's called a plane wave. From here we have some, you know, again some very very basic things. I know maybe you guys know this, but I think it's important that all these things are refreshed, so that if at any point of time you want to sort of, you should not be there should not be any doubt about these things. Okay, you know exactly how these things work. And so from here we will again just write down some very very basic understandings. So, K, E and B form some kind of a right-handed perpendicular system, right? So you have this right? So if I have this as K, this is E, and this is B. How does this come? How does this originate? Huh? What? Yeah, how can we prove this? That they formed a right-handed triad? So, what? K dot E, right? So, essentially what we can do is, we know that, so I'm writing, so, you know, when I write this del operator, that is nothing but, in this case, it's essentially del del Z, right? Correct?
Yes.
Right? So then it follows directly from the, if I have a source free region, that, so basically this is not, so this essentially implies that from the first equation that K dot E is zero, right? For no charges. Is that fine? Del del Z. And it also follows that from the second equation, it follows that A dot B is zero, right? Then we can write those four equations in this form. K cross E equal to omega B, and I'm writing for source free, K cross B equal to minus mu epsilon zero omega E. So essentially from here, you get the thing that K cross E should be equal to B. This is important, this thing, I mean, you know, this order is important, and you will appreciate that the moment we do, you know, to form the, you know, write down the Fresnel equations. Okay, when we write down the Fresnel equations, we will basically, I mean, we derive the Fresnel equations, that is, we will essentially solve some kind of boundary value problems where we have this incident wave, wave incident on a dielectric interface, then the direction of E and B will be crucial because, you know, we will deal with different polarizations, right? We will define, we will deal with the case when we have P polarized light and we have S polarized light. So P polarized light, you know, by the way, what is the meaning of polarization? Polarization is essentially given by the
direction of E.
Why?
Tip of the electric field.
Exactly. Very nice. Bolo. Direction of
The electric field.
Tip of the electric field. And why? Because so E is much, much greater than B, in the sense that what is the relationship? What?
E equals to C times B.
Yes. So we consider the electric field always. Okay. Acha. So now some basics again. Patafat. These are very simple stuff. So we can. So what is the. So can we derive some kind of, you know, relationship between the velocity of light? Can we say that? So what is C given by?
1 by root mu naught epsilon naught.
Okay. So how can we derive that?
From the Maxwell's equations.
Right. So let me just अरे यार ये सब तुम लोगों से करवाना था मुझे बैठ के करना हो रहा है anyway ठीक है चल करते हैं. So suppose I write this k as some k vector k, okay, which means that my k vector k cross e, obviously the vectors now, is omega b, which means that your k e is omega b, which of course means that k by of course this tells you that e equals to cb, or we can also say that k by omega e equals b. Let me just zoom out a bit. How do I go up? Can I go up here? Oh shit. Is there not a way of going up? Oh shit. Okay, I think I just yeah. Okay, right. So we can also write K cross K E by omega equals minus epsilon naught omega E, which means K squared E is epsilon mu omega squared E, and that essentially means that there is a this minus sign is there. Does that matter? Anyway, so K squared by omega squared is mu E epsilon, which means 1 by C squared is mu epsilon, which means C is 1 by root of mu epsilon. Okay? Okay, so this is very, 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 very basic, but still we are going to do this. Okay, so, so now a very, very crucial concept that is, and then from here we are going to some interesting depth. So let me see. So flow of energy. Flow of energy is given by what? Flow of energy?
Pointing vector.
Pointing vector. What is, say, what do we typically, pointing vector essentially means flow of energy, which means energy density per unit time. So energy per unit area per unit time. So what is energy density, by the way, guys? So UE, that is the electric field energy density. Electric field energy density is given by what?
Half epsilon naught E square.
Yes. Anirudh is the class representative. Every question. Are bahut koi bolo. UB is? Ye sab bahut basic hai. Iske baad I'm going to ask a question. Then I'll see how many of you speak. Wait. These are all very, 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 very simple. Total is therefore half epsilon naught E square plus B square by 2 mu. Now, what is your B? That is E by C, which is essentially mu naught epsilon naught E, which means UB is nothing but mu 0 epsilon naught E square by 2 mu 0, which is half epsilon naught E square. Which basically means that my total energy is essentially epsilon naught E square, right? Okay, so again, I'll finish this part quickly, and then go to a very nice conceptual question. So can we derive the expression for pointing vector from here? How can we do that? Very simple. We basically say that, so let the wave travel through, say, an area A with some velocity C. Okay. Essentially, I have something like a cylinder. Okay. So, oh God. Right. So this velocity C essentially means that is the distance, the length that is goes for a unit time, right? And the energy density is essentially U tot. Anna? So this is, so basically that means my energy per unit area, per unit time, that is nothing but your U into C, correct? Right, and what is this U into C? Nothing but you this root of epsilon naught U naught, which I can write as this. I can write this as E dot CB, and this is nothing but mu naught E dot 1 by epsilon naught mu naught B, which means this is 1 by mu naught E dot EB. It's not that the dot is not really I'm considering these are scalars, but the moment I will actually think of flows, then there is some very crucial thing which will come. That is, the moment I talk of pointing, it's a vector, right? Vector, and the direction of energy, the flow of energy is the direction of what? It's in the k direction, right? So basically my S is nothing but 1 by mu 0 E cross B. Very, very simple. Okay, now comes the question that I am itching to ask you. This is nicely telling you that the pointing vector. So I'm saying, okay, great. Let me come to a new discussion. So what we just concluded was that pointing vector is in the k direction. Right? Is that true always? That is my question. Generally, is that always true? Let me see. Can you guys figure this out? You understood the question, right? From here, it is very clear that the pointing vector is in the direction of K. And that's how we define it. We say that this is a flow of energy which goes in the direction of K, and that essentially tells you that the pointing vector only has, this is actually for effect, we should only has a longitudinal component. You understand this? Longitudinal means in the direction of, that is, in the direction of Z. Is that true?
Can you go back to the previous equation where we conclude that it is in the k direction? I couldn't understand that.
Wait. Oh, shit. Okay, now I need it. Okay. Yeah. Oh, why is it so big? Anyway. So basically, I am saying that this is my direction of. The wave is in this direction. I say that this is my, say, this is, oh, wait. Let me not screw it up. Yeah, this is my Z. Okay. This is the way the wave is flowing. Okay. And I generally get that pointing vector essentially is given by, so let me just write this. This is S, and that is given by EB. Okay. And I sort of make a, I define this as flow of energy, right? So flow of energy essentially means something that is going in the direction. So Rohan, this, I'm not saying that this directly follows from this. This is the magnitude of the pointing vector. But we choose to define the pointing vector in the direction of Z. And why is that? Because that follows from here. Because you know that E cross B is K. Right? Okay. E cross B is K. And therefore, obviously, it is only in the direction of Z. right?
Okay.
So basically, we are saying, we are imposing sort of a condition, and which is all, this is all self-sustaining. So there is it does not, when nothing gets hurt. I mean, when I choose this, everything is consistent. Okay. Very crucial. Very, very crucial. Remember, E cross B, what is a very crucial takeaway from our understanding of plane waves? Let us again go back to this. Very important. Where did I? Yeah, here. Here. Oh, not this one, the other one. Where did I write that? This one. Very crucial. These tell us that K dot A is zero. K is the direction of, is perpendicular to E. So if I take this to be the Z direction, what does this tell you about E? What does it tell you about the components of E? What?
It is perpendicular to K.
It is only perpendicular to K. It is absolutely, and so is, can there be an EEZ? Can there be any EZ? No. Very good.
Perpendicular, no.
Right. There is no possibility of any kind of electric field in the direction of propagation, because that is the whole structure of the electromagnetic theory as given by Maxwell's equations. Right? There is absolutely no chance that you will get any kind of propagation in the direction of K. And from all this, we are essentially concluding, we have given the direction of energy as the direction of the wave itself, because, and you know, the way we sort of very simplistically define waves, as I remember many of you guys said in your second year when I asked you what is a wave, you guys said it's a flow of energy. Did you say so? Flow of energy when it's flowing only in the Z direction, in one direction, whatever it's, I say that it flows in the Z direction, which means the energy flows in the Z direction. So my question now is this universally true? What is the feeling of the class?
Sir, no.
Why?
I know, because I just know the one example where I think this is not true, in the case of OAM beams, where I think the K vector rotates, but the direction of energy is still in the straight direction.
Priyanu just jumped the gun. It is correct. Of course, it is not true. The answer is...
That's it. I just know the example, but specifics I do not know. That's
no, but specific, Priyanu, you have to understand the general reason why it is not true. And it's,
sir,
very simple.
In the case of a simple plane wave, it will this will obviously hold true. But if we superimpose two plane waves,
very good.
Yeah.
Superimpose, but if you just, I mean, you are saying that there are different
plane waves that have a different k vector, then
when you are saying for a pulse. But see, Anirudh, again, if you are going to interfere them, then the resultant will be one direction. I mean, you'll get a resultant, right? Why will you think that superposition of plane waves will not have a resultant? There'll be a resultant wave, no? That will again have a direction of propagation, which is, but you know, again, this is going to be true. I mean, pointing vector will still be in the direction, the resultant direction of the wave.
Sir, here we have assumed the Maxwell's equation in isotropic homogeneous medium. So, if the medium is anisotropic, then we might not have the plane wave solution.
That what we are going to study is then D becomes the preferred direction, Rohan, but that is not going to tell you that pointing vector will, so K will no longer be in the direction of V, it will be the direction of D, that we'll learn later. Okay, but that's still, so okay, let me just make the question even more specific. Do you think, can the pointing vector have a transverse component? What transverse component? By the way, if the pointing vector needs to have a transverse component, What does that translate to in the properties of the field?
The electric field can't be perpendicular to the K. I think it has to shift a little.
Sure, shift a little what?
It should. Okay, I need to show this. I can't tell it.
You should be able to tell it. One minute. Your E cross B is still valid. So in order to have a transverse component of that S, what do you need to have in E?
A component along K, I guess.
Absolutely right. You need to have you basically, which this essentially means, you need an EZ. When can that come? Let me go to a new slide. Any reasons for EZ to come? Can you think of anything? When can EZ come? This may be a bit tricky, but just think. EZ, okay. Let me give you a hint. When, yaar, ye mota kaise ho gaya? This is very complicated. Okay.
So like when we have a range of K vectors that are not exactly in the same direction.
Anirudh, I am stuck in this worst thing. Oof, this is all so... Wait, let me just write down. When can... It looks like a baby's writing, yeah? When can EZ arise? Ah, bolo abhi. You are saying you have a range of K vectors. Again, Anirudh, this is the same argument. I will again say you will have a resultant K. I will have a vector addition of K. And I say that there's a resultant.
Okay.
Now the final and absolute hint. Now you'll all get.
Sir,
by the way, you.
There
bolo.
Can be couldn't be because the medium is dielectric.
Yeah, dielectric. Too, it's always there, Adarsh. I mean, what? Why should dielectric? Because we are all assuming dielectric, no?
No, sir. Yeah, because
dielectric. What are we not assuming dielectric? I mean, see, and so you are trying to say what I think Priyanud said or Rohan said earlier, right? That if you have a sort of an anisotropic, you mean dielectric sort of anisotropic media or sort of what? Anisotropic media. Anyway, the properties are not same in all directions, that you're saying. See, in that case, again, I'm saying you're basically, we'll see that D equal to epsilon E, that epsilon will become a tensor. So D will, we will see that the K is in the direction of D. But EZ arising may not arise because of that.
Sir, we assume that K dot E.
Yes. That is the hint. Del dot E zero is absolutely going to hold every time. Now think. Achha, this is the ultimate hint. Those who have done fiber optics, you should be able to say this. Ye main bahut baar bola tha. Del dot E equal to zero. Now connect. Try to connect. Plane wave. Can a plane wave be a general solution for all light? Can a plane wave describe all types of light?
No, sir.
What? No, right.
A Gaussian beam.
Oh God!
Sir, you can do one thing. So you can zoom out the screen a little. I think the ink.
Ink because of that, is it?
I think you zoomed in too much. So that's why it's very. I think now you can write.
Re baap. Wait. Oof! This whole thing is. Why is this to happening, yaar? Oh God! This whole thing is now. Okay, good. Okay, let me come back. So beams, beams, right? So instead of plane waves, which have all, so what is the difference between plane wave and beam?
Is not like this, or rather I should say
beam, difference between plane wave and beams. How does a beam look like? Like that, right?
Finite power.
What is the, absolutely. So plane wave
have plane waves
infinite,
have
finite extent. Beams, finite extent. This makes a fantastically huge difference. Can somebody point out that? Just this. Just saying that I have EX, EY, 0 there, and EX, EY, finite here. So here they are 0. And here they are finite. Huh? So what is the very, so how do you now see? I know you guys are already guessing the answer, but let us go to it methodically. So when I have a plane wave which has infinite extent, this is trivially satisfied, right? This is trivially satisfied because everywhere the thing is existent, right? So the derivative of E is, that is zero straight because there is no variation of E. Is that clear? Right? So for plane waves, del dot E equal to zero is trivially satisfied. Because no variation.
May I interrupt?
Yeah.
Does this EX and EY mean the partial derivative along EX and Y?
No. I am just saying that the moment I define a beam, what I mean to say is outside the boundaries of the beam, there is no field. Inside the boundaries of the beam, the fields are finite. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay, and I say that this is my Z, right? Inside the boundaries of the beam, there is EX, EY, EZ. Outside, it is zero. The moment I say that, so for beams, however, del EX, del X, and del EY, del Y is not zero, right? Straight not zero. Because this is finite here and it is zero outside. They are not zero. The moment you say that, that obviously means there has to be a finite del EZ, EZ, del EZ. I mean, basically a Z component of the derivative of E, which means there is a finite EZ. The moment you say, I truncate a plane wave, that straight leads to generation of EZ. This is very nice, and somehow our books still don't highlight this, but this is absolutely and tremendously crucial, especially in the context of how, you know, optics is sort of getting understood. I mean, you know, how we do optics these days. It is very important to note that plane waves are a very special case to understand, you know, to basically solve. Obviously, they help in solving a whole class of problems, but they certainly do not describe reality. And the moment you have a finite EZ implies a finite SZ. And that, oh, sorry. Finite is sorry. ST.
that is a transverse component of, which I can also say as S XY, which means that you now have a transverse pointing vector. And this is exemplified, this is actually increased considerably when, this is increased, can you tell me when this will, when the amount of EZ will increase? So, okay, so the question is, so the question that I have towards you, to for you is, when do you, when will EZ increase? What conditions will EZ increase?
Sorry, what is it? What conditions will EZ increase?
Will what will cause a larger amount of EZ to happen? What I'm saying is that, I mean, you know, what the Z component of the field essentially will not be the same every time, right? So when do you think the Z component will actually increase? When do you have a large Z component? For example, if you actually look at beams, just normal beams like this that I'm showing, Gaussian beams, laser beams, the Z component is actually very small, extremely small, so that you can actually neglect it. In fact, that is how, you know, when we actually, you know, you think of it, right? When we write down the Gaussian solution. Oh, so, okay, very good. Let me come again, you guys need to connect the dots. When do you think we actually neglect the Z component? When do you think that we consider the Z component? When we consider the structure of beams?
Sir, when EX and EY very, very slowly.
Yes. No, okay. Anirudh has answered my previous question. That is absolutely correct. But what I'm trying to now ask you is a different question. This structure of ignoring the Z component is actually a very powerful assumption. Can you tell me somewhere where we actually, you know, in spite of knowing it's not true, where we still enforce it?
Paraxial wave equation.
Absolutely. So when we write down the paraxial wave equation, we still ignore this Z component. We ignore the Z component. We actually say that the variation is extremely small and it is much, much smaller than del EX, this thing. And so you throw it out. You don't consider it. And remember, of course, we will do this again in detail, but I want you to connect everything because it is essential for you to have a picture. Knowledge comes only when you form pictures. Okay. So the picture that I want you to form is, we typically, even when we write down the solution for beams, we still assume that in the Z direction, we have a plane wave. We don't assume something which is actually having a finite Z component of the electric field. In the sense, you know, we still do not consider the pointing vector having a transverse component. However, just as Anirudh said, if you have a case where EX and EY vary slowly or vary less, you have a large EZ. And that actually happens when you do tight focusing or when you actually do.
Sir,
yeah.
It will be small EZ, not large. When EY will vary very quickly, then it will be a large EZ, right?
No. Anirudh, in the sense that when they are very large, then in the sense that you kind of, now see, there is one very important thing, okay? There is an important thing here. What we are saying is that if you are saying, if this is propagating in the Z, right? This is a very important concept. When it's propagating in the Z, I am saying that the change in Z is much lesser than the change in X and Y. See, remember, in the paraxial approximation, why do we ignore del EZ, del Z? Because we say that the spread in EX, EY, that is much higher. I mean, the cutoff, how it is cut off, means in the sense that, you know, EX, EY exists at the boundary and then suddenly becomes zero, right? However, in the Z, it's propagating forever. So the change in Z actually is much slower. That is the reason that I can actually ignore del EZ, del Z, in spite of it being there. You understand? However, if I have a situation where I have this beam, say, you know, coming like that, and then I have, oh God, I have this, I have this beam like this, and really getting tightly focused, really diverging, right? In that case, the spread of Delhi's of AX and EY are much slower. So you cannot ignore the change in Delhi Z, Del Z with respect to that. You understand? The logic is that in the case of a beam, because your Delhi X, Delhi Y are suddenly sort of, you know, cut off. So basically you say that you ignore Delhi Z, Del Z, saying that it is much smaller. However, it is there. I'm saying the paradoxical wave equation, we choose to ignore it and get away with it. We get away with it. That is very crucial. When we tightly focus, we cannot get away with it. Okay, we have to incorporate the presence of the variation of Delhi Z, Del Z, of right, the variation of Delhi Z, Del Z, as well as Delhi X, Del X. Okay, so is that what? Do you sort of agree with that?
Yes, sir, it's clear.
Okay, so basically that is the reason. Oh God, it became green pen. No, fine. Okay, so that essentially means that tight focusing generates large EZ, and that leads to some extremely interesting problems, which are okay, so these are again maybe projects some people can do, things called as the spin Hall effect. So Hall effect, you guys have some idea, right? Do you know what Hall effect is? Hall effect semiconductors, Hall voltage, clear hai? Pata hai? Hall effect, when you have, again nothing.
I don't think they have condensed
matter. Hey, Hall effect you have not studied at all, is it? Okay, Hall effect basically means that when you have a magnetic field and then there is this electric voltage and then there is basically the electrons get displaced in the transverse direction. Okay, it happens in semiconductors quite a bit. So the same thing happens in light when you tightly focus. Essentially, there's a, so in Hall effect, what you have is a Hall voltage, which is perpendicular to the trajectory of the current. So you have current in one direction, but there is actually a voltage in the direction perpendicular to that flow. There is the same thing for optics. When you actually have so-called a beam that is propagating in the Z, you actually have some energy, however, in the XY. That is very beautiful. And that is some kind of a, you can say that, you know, something where the paradoxical equation of course breaks down, and the plane wave, you know, these Maxwell's, you know, these assumptions are all sort of going to break down. Okay, so that is very important, which I think was something that I wanted you to sort of ponder about, because you know, finally you guys are really entering physics, you know, solid things in physics, so you know, you should just keep thinking about these things. Okay, so it's already 6, but we started a bit late. Shall we start, continue with this little bit on the thing that we want to do, or should we all start next class? So basically what we want to start is how, you know, EM waves behave at the boundary of two dielectrics. Maybe it's a better thing to start it next class. Okay. So any questions, guys? This was, I hope, a discussion which did not bore you in spite of us not seeing each other. Any questions? Any questions?
Can you explain the tight focusing part?
So tight focusing basically means this. So I'm coming with, so loose focusing. So let me write this. Keep forgetting. So if I say that this is tight focusing, then your loose focusing this. So essentially, where you have a very, very short focal length lens, you have the beam focusing very close to the lens pupil itself, exit pupil. Okay, so there are a lot of consequences in that. So essentially, I think I discussed this in the previous class where we said that when we have the focal length very small, then it is essential that this spot size also is very small, which again you can intuitively understand, because the beam diverges here more than it diverges here. So you can say that this spot has to be smaller than this spot. So essentially, if you have this kind of a beam diameter, that gets condensed to an extremely small spot, whereas the same diameter here that has a much bigger focal spot size here. And the reason, of course, is that, you know, why this happens, that is essentially Gaussian beam optics, which we are going to study. Okay, let me draw the arrows so that we can understand what is happening. Okay, so this is a integral factor of Gaussian beam optics, where you have a Gaussian beam, you know, the way it interacts with the lens. When the smaller the focal length, the smaller is the beam spot size. So the tight focusing essentially means that I am condensing the beam focal spot, beam spot, I should say, to a very, very small or a tight spot. I'm focusing it very tightly. So the beam spot size is reducing very considerably. Clear?
Yes, but how that will affect the in the large EZ?
So basically what I meant was, when you have this kind of a beam, right? So this beam essentially means that my EX was finite before the boundary, and just outside it just disappeared, right? So the del EX, del X, etc. were large, okay? But the Z, the beam is continuously propagating in the Z, right? There it is basically, it is that unless there's an obstruction, it's not going to stop. It's just going to continuously flow. So the rate of change of the electric field with respect to Z is much smaller than the rate of change of the electric field with respect to X and Y. So we ignore del EZ, del Z with respect to del EX, del X, and del EY, del Y. Here, however, the change of X and Y are much lesser compared, because it's like gradually expanding, right? So then I cannot ignore del EZ, del Z with respect to del EX, del X, and del EY, del Y. Or del EX, del Y. I cannot sort of ignore the gradient of EZ with respect to the gradient of X and Y. Therefore, I am saying that I have to consider a finite, a large EZ in these cases compared to here. Is that clear?
Yes.
Because the rate of change of EX and EY are much smaller here than the rate of change of EX, EY here. That is the reason. Okay?
Okay.
Any other questions, guys? See, I'll try to go slow because I realize that this is not a best way of teaching. But if you ever think that I'm going fast, just stop me. We'll just discuss, okay, in the future. Okay. So any other questions? Tell me. Otherwise, we stop. Next class, we pick up EM, electromagnetic wave at dielectric interface. Okay?
So fine.
Okay, okay. So next class Monday at 6 p.m. right? 6 p.m. and I'll try to set it by that Google Meet thing that I think Rohan told us. Hopefully it'll work. Okay, chalo, bye, stay safe, have a good weekend.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, bye.